皆さん、こんに
ちは。We are to start a seminar on the Asia Pacific energy transition and Japan's role. Yesterday, we had a RA Vision, which was an international conference and symposium, and there are many speakers from abroad. And we thought we'd like to take advantage of that occasion of having many speakers here to focus on decarbonization issue in Asia and Australia. Amongst South Asia, especially Indonesia, and also Australia, Japan and those countries have very deep relationship. We import fossil fuel from those countries. And in Japan, there are such arguments saying that Southeast Asia has a renewable energy gap or limited potential or too much focus on the solar. And the introduction of a variable renewable energy requires thermal power for adjustment. Those are the discussion often we hear in Japan. Are they really true? So today, we'll hear from speakers about the region's renewable energy's current situation and challenges, as well as what are global discussions from three speakers. And then after that, we'll have a break for about 30 minutes for networking purpose. And then there will be a panel discussion to discuss the role of Japan. And then, if everything goes smooth, we'd like to take questions from the floor as well. And I am sorry that I'm not being able to regain my normal voice. I'm really sorry if it's disturbing, but I'm really excited about this event today. So I'd like to introduce the first speaker, who's the Matthew David Wittenstein, who is the Chief of Section of Energy Connectivity at UN ESCAP. He'll be speaking title on the power grid interconnections to accelerate Asia's energy transition. So as a non-fire adjustment means, currently, there's a discussion about the enhancement of the network, and I hope to hear that topic from him. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Such a pleasure to be here. I'll try to set the scene a little bit, but let me first quickly introduce the organization that I represent. I'm with the United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. We're one of five UN regional economic commissions. We have 53 member states, so we're the largest in terms of population covered. We're not a sector-focused entity, but I work in energy division, and in particular, I work on energy connectivity. And that really is going to be the through line for my presentation today, sort of this one takeaway that I'm hoping you'll come away with after I'm done. It's that the only way we're really going to accelerate and meet our climate ambitions is through cooperation and collaboration. One thing that's also important to keep in mind, and I'll make a few quick points before I get to the substance of my presentation, is that Asia-Pacific really has, in the past few years, become the major driver of global greenhouse gas emissions growth. What that means in practice is if we are going to meet climate change goals, meet the Paris Agreement targets, energy transition needs to accelerate in Asia-Pacific in particular. The good news is there are an increasing number of countries that have set ambitions to achieve net zero emissions in the coming decades. More and more in line with what we know we need for Paris Agreement, although not fully there yet. So we need to do two things. One, we need to bring more countries on board. So it's great to see so many acknowledging the need to achieve net zero emissions, but we need to make sure they're doing so across the board. And we also need to do so in a way that's more relevant to the context of our region. So not simply saying net zero by 2050, but acknowledging diversity of resources, diversity of levels of development, and diversity of needs. And in particular, one thing we have noted in our region is that poorer countries are struggling to develop and deploy renewable energy. We have seen an incredible acceleration in the deployment of wind and solar in particular in our region, as well as other enabling technologies like batteries. but primarily in developed economies. And so if we are really going to achieve a just and equitable energy transition, we also need to make sure that developing countries can fully take advantage of the technological solutions that we're deploying at scale already in countries like Japan, like China, like the United States. As part of that, and this really is what drives a lot of my work, is a recognition that countries really can't do this alone. Ultimately, we need to collaborate across many different dimensions. One chart I usually like to show is from the International Energy Agency's net zero scenario, where they showed that without any collaboration at all, if countries simply tried to work on their own to achieve net zero goals, they would need an additional 70 years to reach the net zero targets. One particular aspect of that that I'd like to focus on is the fact that larger integrated power systems are one tool that we can leverage to enable the secure, efficient, and rapid integration of renewable energy resources. Just showing this chart on the left, what that shows is wind patterns in four countries in Europe. And it's a very simple story. While wind, of course, is variable, and it varies quite a lot, often even within the day, and of course across seasons, across larger and larger geographic territories, the variation in wind patterns is lower. The average wind is much more smooth, which means if we have large enough grids to take advantage of that sort of natural variations in weather patterns, we can more easily integrate wind in particular, or solar, as the sun moves across the sky. And this, I should say, is not something that I've invented. It's something that's been recognized by many, many, many people for many, many years. And our member states have also acknowledged this. In 2021, they endorsed the Regional Roadmap on Power System Connectivity, which contains 9 strategies for enabling secure and efficient power system connectivity to enable energy transition. I won't go through these strategies in depth, but there's a link somewhere. No, the link is not here. Apologies. There's usually a link. I forgot it on this slide. That shows the details behind the strategies. But basically, it talks about the need to coordinate on planning, financing, operational issues, and some fundamental underlying cross-cutting issues, such as the need for political will and trust, and ensuring that connectivity is aligned with and supportive of sustainable development. As I said, I'm not the first to talk about this. There are already many multilateral initiatives across the Asia-Pacific region that are trying to enable collaboration on energy issues. This is not an exhaustive list, but a pretty comprehensive list of the ones that we have identified and often work with directly. Northeast Asia stands out, actually, as the one where we have the least activity in terms of actual concrete collaboration on energy issues. Every year, ESCAP organizes the NearPIC Forum. We will organize it again later this year, which focuses on connectivity for Northeast Asia and opportunities for collaboration. There is also work by ADB through what they call NAPSI, which has mostly focused on the opportunity for Mongolia to become a renewable energy powerhouse for the region. But in contrast to other parts of our region, there are no concrete proposals to do multilateral planning of grids, to actually develop cross-border infrastructure at large scale, to develop regional markets. So one of the things that I'm trying to encourage is more collaboration, in particular in Northeast Asia, and in particular at the technical level, because there's lots of opportunity, at least for knowledge exchange. But let me talk in particular about different modalities of connectivity, because it's also important to sort of frame this as not one type of path forward, but actually many that might hopefully come together in some coherent way. When we think about models of cross-border integration, perhaps the most common that we see in our region is what we would call point-to-grid, where you basically take a generator in one country or territory, and you link it into your grid across some border. So that could be even within a country, right? Maybe it's a distant hydro plant that I'm using a long-distance DC line to bring to my city or town. But often it could also mean building, for example, in Laos, hydro that then gets imported into Thailand. But that hydro is exclusively utilized by Thailand and doesn't directly contribute to Laos' power system. It's easy to deploy because it's very certain in the sense of you know what you're building, you know what you're utilizing. It does require, of course, bilateral agreement. But because it's very focused on a project, usually it's sort of easier to move it forward. But it's very limited in its potential. You have to build a new line for every new project. You don't have the opportunity for bidirectional trading. And it's harder to optimize regional resources if you simply use a point-to-grid model. So we are often advocating now to move more to what we call grid-to-grid, which is basically saying we have two grids. Let's bridge them in some way. Could be through synchronization. Could be through a high-voltage DC line. But let's leverage all of the resources on both sides of the border and allow for some exchange. And that helps both to make sure we can do this in an optimal way, but also in a way that's more flexible. And flexibility is the key word, really, going forward. As we integrate more renewable energy, flexibility of resources is going to be increasingly important because we need to balance all the wind and solar that we know is coming into the system. So this really is a good path forward, but it's more complicated. It requires a lot more deep collaboration at the utility level and political levels, and benefits often from the presence of some overlaying regional institution that can help guide the process in some way. Another model we see, not in our region so much, but in other regions, in particular Central America, is what we call the shared backbone model, which basically says, let's not use our existing infrastructure, let's build a new overlay grid, and we all just tap into that. That has some advantages in the sense of it's limited infrastructure, so you can talk about cost sharing in a more simple fashion, but it's also limited in the sense of it's now an opportunity to basically limit, but almost by definition, the level of ambition. You're now limited by that backbone interconnector. Grid to grid allows you to really expand quite rapidly to deep integration like you have in Europe. But with the backbone interconnector, once you've built that, unless you're going to build more lines like that, you kind of can't go any further. That makes it easier to measure the benefits and the costs, but also allows for some free riding. You can simply use your backbone grid as a way of avoiding domestic grid investments. And that actually has been a real problem in Central America. The market is breaking because countries are overutilizing the regional grid at the expense of their domestic grids. Grid-to-grid doesn't have that issue, but requires more investment, which can be challenging when you have developed and developing economies working together. And the last example, and I think I've talked a bit too long about this, is the hybrid model, where we take a resource, maybe offshore somewhere, say some offshore wind, and I'll come back to that example again, and jointly develop it, because maybe it sits closer to two borders or three borders. This is now being pursued in the North Sea, for example, or Northern Europe. We have lots of wind resources and many countries looking to develop them. Why should they compete for a common resource when it's more efficient and cheaper and ultimately more secure to build a grid that allows all those resources to flow wherever they're needed, whenever they're needed? And by the way, you can also then tie that to other types of infrastructure like hydrogen and use it for more than just power production, but power to X. So this is, I think, a really interesting model to consider in a Northeast Asian context. But again, it requires much deeper levels of collaboration and cooperation at the utility level, regulatory level, and political level. Now, I'll spend a couple of seconds talking about some work we did on Northeast Asia, looking at the benefits of connectivity. A lot of proposals have been put forward, including by Renewable Energy Institute, for how to integrate the grids of Northeast Asia. But we did a study a couple of years ago and noted that many of those proposals were many years old, and they were missing in particular two factors. One, the real steep decline in renewable energy costs over the past few years, and also the decline in costs of other enabling technologies, like transmission, of course, but also storage. And the fact that many of the countries now have net zero targets. So they've made an explicit goal to achieve net zero emissions, which was not the case when many of these studies were first done. So we looked at the possibility of leveraging Northeast Asia's significant and diverse renewable energy potential, and of course, growing demand, especially in many countries for example, Mongolia or Korea, or sorry, in China. And asked the question, what if we raise the ambition on the level of interconnection? Right now, we have some bilateral interconnections, in particular between Mongolia and its neighbors, or China and Russia, but they're limited in scope. And so we asked, what if we increase those and integrate all the grids together and allowed for multilateral power trading? Let's see what happens. And what we found are essentially two main things. We could dig into it. The report is online. Happy if you go and read it. But there really are two findings that I want to emphasize. One is it leads to lower costs for everybody. I think that's a critically important and often overlooked benefit of connectivity. We talk about the security concerns over connectivity, and those are valid, but I think often overblown. And what you really miss is the fact that if we do this, we will all save money. It is simply cheaper to collaborate, build more renewables than you could otherwise for only domestic demand, share the cost of resources, and also save money on operations because you're more efficiently utilizing these resources across a larger territory. But the other thing is, it's an accelerator of energy transition. It's important to emphasize that connectivity by itself does not bring energy transition. It is still a necessary policy goal for countries to agree. We want to increase renewable energy deployment. We want to set targets for carbon emission reductions. All that still needs to happen. But if you have, for example, a 2050 net zero target and you utilize connectivity, you will get there faster and for less money and ultimately more securely. because you can leverage the resources of multiple countries, not only for flexibility, but also for more fundamental reserve requirements or anything that sort of keeps you, the lights online during periods of low wind or low sun. So how would we seek to accelerate progress? And I'm focusing here primarily on the technical details. I mean, let's put aside the political challenges, of which, of course, there are many. And I don't want to say they don't exist, but I do think we often overlook the fact that technical collaboration can actually help us achieve progress even in the face of political obstacles. And in particular, I see two needs. And by the way, these needs are also, I think, very useful to consider at the national level. So even if we only think about the Japanese context, these might still be helpful. One is we need to ensure we have sufficient enabling infrastructure to allow the integration of higher shares of renewable energy. And the second is we need the incentives in place to ensure the efficient operation of power systems that are increasingly utilizing variable resources like wind and solar. So when it comes to enabling infrastructure, we need long-term market incentives to allow cost recovery for very capital-intensive investments. Grids, of course, but renewable energy, perhaps nuclear, if that becomes something that is a priority for, I know it is a priority for Japan, maybe for other countries in the region as well. But also, we need to make sure that once we have those technologies in place, we utilize them appropriately. So we also need shorter-term markets for flexibility, and especially ones that allow us to trade power across borders. Even within Japan, that could mean more trade between the utilities, building up more domestic infrastructure and allowing power to flow from Hokkaido all the way to Kyushu and back. Right? And all of this needs to be underlined by political will at all levels and alignment with sustainable development. We need at all stages to ensure that we are considering our long-term sustainable development goals and how connectivity services those goals. I want to highlight a couple of specific case studies. I won't go into these in depth. You can read them at your leisure if you'd like. But this is an ambitious project. Maybe some of you have heard of it, the Sun Cable proposal. Singapore is seeking to decarbonize its power system. Singapore, I'm sure you know, is a small island. It cannot, using domestic resources alone, fully decarbonize. They know, they have acknowledged, they need to import renewable energy. Singapore has a fully restructured wholesale market, and they have simply opened up the process to say anyone can propose a project to deliver power to us in a certain time frame to make sure that we can achieve our net zero targets. So the Sun Cable is the most ambitious of these. It's a proposal to build tremendous amounts of solar and battery storage in northern Australia and deliver that by a more than 4,000 plus kilometer long subsea HVDC cable directly to Singapore through Indonesian territory, waters at least. Just for context, right now the current record holder for the longest subsea DC cable is in Europe. It's just, I think, 780 kilometers, like just under 800 kilometers. Right? So we're talking about something that's significantly more ambitious than anything that's ever been built. But what's driving the ambition is the recognition of two things. One, the technology costs have declined to the point where it is actually, in theory at least, achievable to deliver power, according to Sun Cable, at a cost-competitive price to be delivered into the Singaporean market at below their average wholesale price, which, to be fair, is also relatively high by Southeast Asian standards. But the other part of this is what Singapore is asking for. They are not simply asking for renewables. They have set specific requirements for what kind of power should be delivered. It needs to be low carbon, not zero carbon, at least not yet. Maybe someday it will go there, but low enough that it can't just be a gas generator. It has to be renewables backed by something else. It also needs to be able to provide system services, that's regulation and reserve. So it's not just the flow of energy. It has to be able to be seen as providing services to the grid as a whole to help maintain security of supply. And also should be as reliable as domestic generation, which on average has an uptime of 90%. Right? So if you're building a solar farm, you need to be able to ensure you have a high quality resource and back it up with batteries so you can deliver at night. The option in Northern Australia actually fits a lot of that. They have one of the best solar resources in the world. They have significant amounts of territory that they can utilize, including brownfields. So you're not tearing things down that otherwise you want to preserve. So it's possible, at least in theory, but in practice, we'll see what happens. Let me skip this one, actually. Let me talk a little bit more about the Japanese context. So in Japan, we talk a lot about wind potential, but also I think the acknowledgement that offshore wind has a challenge of it being very much a deep sea. There's not a lot of the opportunities for cheap offshore wind like you've seen in Northern Europe because you don't have subsea beds that are close to the surface of the water. What I just want to advocate for here, this goes back to that hybrid model. If we consider a hybrid model across, for example, the part of the ocean that's closer to Korea, we could potentially leverage the wind resources in a way that's more affordable for both Japan and Korea by taking advantage of the fact that they can build bigger by serving larger sources of demand. And also, if you build an interconnector to both territories to leverage that wind, you can build it more securely. You can leverage it more securely because you can allow the power to flow to wherever demand is needed, or demand is, and also allow for bidirectional flows between Korea and Japan, take advantage of difference in industrial loads, for example, or different difference in terms of timing of peak load. I'm going to end by just talking about the last thing I mentioned when it comes to the roadmap, which is our how we think about aligning connectivity with sustainable development. As I mentioned, connectivity is not a guarantee of sustainable development, so we need some kind of a tool, a guiding framework to help countries ensure that when they build connectivity projects, they're aligned with the SDGs and in particular achieving climate change mitigation goals and decarbonization. So we have developed, or are developing, I should say, the Green Power Corridor framework. I won't go into it in depth, but again, we do have a version of it online, which you can read if you're interested. Basically, the idea here is a set of guiding principles organized across a set of 6 building blocks that allow you to, wherever you are in your process, either from the earliest stage of conception to active integration and operations, have a window into how you can improve sustainability and inclusiveness of these connectivity projects. And we're this year adding to these principles a set of metrics to allow you to measure at a high level, very simple light touch metrics to say, as a first touch, is this actually increasing sustainable development across different dimensions? And if it is, then maybe I should pursue it. If not, what am I doing wrong? So we will actually finalize that and deliver it fully this year. So I'm happy to come back and present it at a future date. I have some key takeaways. I won't say these in depth, but basically, like I said, if there's any particular takeaway that I'm hoping you'll walk away from this presentation with, is that we need to collaborate more. Interconnection, integration really brings multiple benefits for energy transition. And across all the dimensions we care about, affordability, sustainability, and security. And as the share of renewable energy grows, the benefits only increase, which means we really should start now to prepare for that future we know is coming. When we talk about interconnection, let's think about what it means to really think about at the grid-to-grid level, deeper collaboration, deeper integration, deeper need for political support. And no matter what we do, we need to make sure we're always considering whether what we're doing is aligned with our sustainable development targets and goals. I'll leave it at that. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much. And given a limited amount of time, you gave us a very rich information and insights. So the economically rational and the enhanced renewable energy usage and security, the connectivity can lead to all of those. Multiple benefits were discussed. And thank you very much. Our next speaker is Roman Zisler, a senior researcher of Renewable Energy Institute. He'll be discussing the future of renewable energy in South Asia. So there is a massive potential of renewable energy in Southeast Asia. And what are the challenges to leverage that? And what are the potential? The floor is yours, Zisler.
Kubo-san. So today, my presentation will focus on the future of renewable energy in Southeast Asia. And without further ado, I will get started. First of all, I would like to let you know that in this fiscal year, the Renewable Energy Institute has pursued efforts in providing information about the energy transition in Southeast Asia per sector. In September, we published a first report covering the entire region. But recognizing that each country faces a different situation, we have also decided to move forward with country case study. At the beginning of this week, we published our first case study dedicated to Indonesia. And this report has benefited from the expertise of the IESR. And Fabi Tumiwa is here with us today. She's its executive director, so you can be sure there is good level information. I will start my presentation with 2 key findings. You can forget almost everything else in this presentation, but not this. The first thing is that it is very clear that renewable energy is the most important supply-side solution to decarbonize Southeast Asian countries' power sector. And there are two main reasons behind that. First is that the region has an abundant and largely untapped renewable energy potential. This potential is various, and it enables to have a good complementarity of different technologies. The second is that there is already a good cost competitiveness of renewable energy against fossil power, including coal. And the other key finding is that there are challenges to accelerate the growth of renewable energy in Southeast Asia, but these challenges are mainly political and regulatory, so they are manageable. In the first part of my presentation, I will focus on the great renewable energy opportunity. This is what has happened since 2010. I'm sorry, there is no data for 2023 yet, but in a few weeks, I think the ARENA will make this data available. The installed capacity of renewable energy technology has more than tripled since 2010, from 33 gigawatts to more than 100. Growth has mainly been concentrated into hydropower and solar power, and has actually mainly taken place in one country, Vietnam. In terms of electricity generation mix, so how does renewable energy compare with other technologies? As of 2022, renewable energy were accounting for more than a quarter of the region's electricity generation, almost the same share as gas and a little smaller than coal. Now, this is really a very, very important number, the economic potential of renewable energy in Southeast Asia. So there are different estimates, but this one is showing what can be developed at a cost or a levelized cost of electricity below $100 per megawatt hour, which I think is affordable. So 40,000 terawatt hour per year. If you compare this number with the actual generation in 2022, it was only 1,200 terawatt hour. Now, if we consider the fact that, yes, Southeast Asia is a dynamically growing region in terms of economics, in terms of demographics, the generation could increase to around 4,500 or 6,400 terawatt hour. So still, even with this growth, the renewable energy potential of the region exceeds by many folds the needs for electricity in the region. This potential is mainly solar power. But let me be clear, it's not only solar power. Just solar power resource is enormous, but the other potential for renewable energy is also significant. But I will start with solar power. The United States National Renewable Energy Laboratory estimates that the potential for solar PV that can be developed at a cost below $100 per megawatt hour is 36,000 terawatt hour. That is really, really enormous. In terms of onshore wind, the potential is much smaller, but still, it is very significant. At least 800 terawatt hour that can be developed at a cost between $40 and $100 per megawatt hour. And well, if you look at the case Vietnam, for example, this potential that could be developed at less than $100 exceeds. It's more than double the country's actual electricity generation total. A little bit of information about offshore wind. The offshore wind potential is relatively similar to that of onshore wind. There are two countries with excellent resources, the Philippines and Vietnam. And you can see a lot of white around Indonesia. So it doesn't seem to be so promising, like the wind speed is a little slow. But what you need to know is also that Indonesia is the world's largest archipelago. And there are also areas where offshore wind could be developed. And we are witnessing some positive developments in the field of offshore wind. Vietnam has announced targets of 6 gigawatts by 2030 and of 70 to 91.5 gigawatts by 2050. And also in the Philippines, the government is managing to attract a lot of interest for prospective bidders. I have talked about renewable energy potential. I would like to talk about cost competitiveness now. And I think this is a really the fight in the region, solar PV against coal. If we looked at the situation in 2014, the cost of solar PV was 3 times higher than that of coal. Sorry, I need to specify a little bit what I call Southeast Asia here. It's 5 countries, Malaysia, Indonesia, the Philippines, Thailand, and Vietnam, which together account for about 90% of the region's total electricity generation. So back in 2014, 3 times more expensive. And last year, solar PV could become cheaper than coal. One of the reasons was the increase in the fuel cost of coal. But this year, we have seen the cost of coal decreasing, but yet solar PV managed to stay cheaper. So this is a new reality. Already, new solar PV is cheaper than new coal in Southeast Asia. Any attempt to fit CCS or to co-fire coal with ammonia will make coal power more expensive. So it's kind of game over already. Solar is cheaper. But it's not only solar PV, which has a relatively good cost competitiveness. It's almost all renewable energy technologies. Under best conditions, it is feasible to develop renewable energy projects which are cheaper than coal or gas today. And you can think, if there was introduction or widespread adoption of carbon pricing in the region, what this would make the cost advantage of renewable energy will be even stronger. So these are some projections of what the future can look like. These projections, they come from 3 different organizations. First, the International Energy Agency, IEA, then the IRENA, International Renewable Energy Agency, and then there is a couple of organizations which have collaborated, the Economic Research Institute for ASEAN and East Asia, and the Institute for Energy Economics Japan, ENEKEN. So all these organizations, they agree that by 2030, the share of renewable energy will have reached approximately 40% of the region's total electricity generation. By 2050 now, the intergovernmental bodies, the IEA and IRENA, they are saying it's going to be between 85% and 90%. And then ELIA and IEJ, they say, 62% is more realistic. And we will need some hydrogen and ammonia. The reasons why there are different results in these scenarios is because the ELIA and IEJ, they are more conservative about grid expansion and about battery storage. However, ELIA and IEJ, they have also developed another alternative scenario, which is called Power Innov. In this scenario, they are more aggressive about cross-border electricity trade and battery storage. And they find out that the share of renewable energy could be increased by 20 percentage points. And that would be to the detriment of hydrogen and ammonia. What's more, this Power Innov scenario would be more cost efficient than the scenario on the screen. So I think it's pretty clear. The best way to decarbonize Southeast Asia power sector is renewable energy. So that's the priority. This makes me question why the Japanese government is so much pushing its Asia Zero Emission Community initiative and its Asia CCUS network initiative. With these initiatives, they are focusing on this tiny, small niche. Why? You don't go for what is the biggest business? You really need to target what is small? And this is the last opportunity. It's about the clean energy technology manufacturing. In this slide, I focus on solar PV, but it's not only about solar PV. Today, the entire supply chain is dominated by China. I don't think it's desirable from an energy security perspective. Southeast Asia is today the main alternative to China for solar PV manufacturing. When it comes to silicon cells or PV modules, about 9-10% of these solar PV segments are covered by Southeast Asian countries, especially Thailand, Malaysia, and Vietnam. And they may soon be joined by Indonesia. There has been a lot of positive announcements about new gigawatt-scale manufacturing capacity for solar PV in Indonesia, including investments by SEG Solar, which is an American company, and also China, which is a Chinese company. I think having domestic manufacturing capacity of solar PV will facilitate the domestic adoption, especially in countries where local content requirements is an important criteria, such as in Indonesia. It will help strengthen energy security of these countries, because not all countries in Southeast Asia are exporting fossil fuels. But it will also help strengthen the energy security of the entire world, so that we are less dependent on China. And I think that's also a sustainable source of income for Southeast Asian countries, because this is high added value products. And I will not talk about it right now in details, but Indonesia is now trying to develop itself as a leading hub for electric vehicle battery. And that makes sense, because Indonesia is already the world's largest nickel producer. I will now talk about the challenges to accelerate renewable energy growth. There are four. And I will first start with the medium-term decarbonization policies, where I see a problem of ambition. We should praise Southeast Asian countries for having adopted long-term decarbonization goals, which are either net zero emissions or carbon neutrality by 2050, 2065. This is good. But to turn these long-term targets into a reality, you also need to pave the way. And there, I think, there is work to be done. I will not pick any example from the table. You have the figure. The medium-term targets for renewable energy electricity, they are insufficient. They should be more aggressive. On a more positive note, this issue is manageable. Southeast Asian countries can become more ambitious, but it will not only be about being more ambitious. More continuity is also needed. We could observe a boom and bust cycle in Vietnam, where a generous feed-in tariff spurred a quick uptake of the technology, but it was almost too fast, and the policy has been temporarily stopped, which is exactly what we do not want to see. In this regard, I think there are some good examples to be mentioned. One is the new Thailand feed-in tariff, which I like because it's a multi-year planning with control of incentives and volumes for each renewable energy technology. So that should also help make the work of the transmission or the grid operator easier. Other good examples, the large-scale solar PV auction program in Malaysia and the Philippines Green Energy Auction Program. I would also like to briefly mention again the importance of carbon pricing. And here we can praise Indonesia for having introduced mandatory carbon pricing. Demand is still low, and the price is also low for this in terms of carbon price. But, well, that's a first good step in the right direction. Second challenge, coal power lock-in. For those of you who were there yesterday, it was mentioned by one of the speakers. There are four obstacles. First, the fleet of coal power plants is massive. It's, as of January 2024, 114 gigawatts. If you remember, one of my first slides was the installed renewable energy capacity in 2022. It was just over 102. So we have roughly the same amount. And the issue is that this fleet is large, but it's also very young. So less than 15 years. So if you want to have a phase-out of coal power and an accelerated phase-out of coal power in Southeast Asia, most likely financial support will be necessary. Another obstacle is that the pipeline for a new power plant is still rather significant. Under construction, there is another 15 gigawatts. Under pre-construction, 19 gigawatts. And shelved, there is 10 gigawatts. So shelved, maybe it's unclear. It means projects which are not moving forward at the moment. They could be cancelled, but they could also be resumed. I think the current dynamic is rather that they would be cancelled, but I only see what I only believe what I see. Third obstacle regarding coal power lock-in, long-term power purchase agreements. So once the plant is up and running, if you want to terminate the PPA early, you will have to pay penalties. And finally, unfair subsidies. Some countries in Southeast Asia are still actively subsidizing the use of coal, which is makes the competition biased with other technologies. Some solutions. I will try to be brief. I will mention just energy transition partnership and energy transition mechanism, which I think are relatively complementary pieces. You have the explanation. I will not read for the sake of time. I would rather talk about the example of Indonesia. In November 23, Indonesia launched its comprehensive investment and policy plan. It aims to mobilize more than $20 billion to support the acceleration of emission reduction in the power sector. In this framework, for example, the share of renewable energy for 2030 is increased to 44%, which is positive. And with regards to the ETM, two plants have been identified and action is being considered to retire these power plants ahead of their schedule, of their closure schedule. Third challenge, electric system reform. It's largely incomplete. Overall, in Southeast Asia, we can say that there is a lack of competition, with the exception of the generation segment. In the supply segment, if we consider the five major power systems, only in the Philippines, there is a little bit of competition allowed. Otherwise, the utilities are still vertically integrated utilities involved in all the segments of the power sector, with either regulated national monopolies or regional monopolies. And typically, this type of structure is preventing the entrance of new participants in the market and also the advancement of new business models. And here, I think we'll need some forward-thinking power market participants, unless electric system reform is resumed. And I selected a couple of examples of companies which have done at least some good work. One is the participation of Japanese companies, INPEX, Hitotsu, and Kyushu Electric Power Company in the Sarula Geothermal Power Plant project in Indonesia. And also, because I'm French, I selected ENGIE, which has invested in solar power in Malaysia. But it's not going to be only about the supply side. It's also important that people on the demand side take action. And as of the end of last year, there were more than 175 companies, member of RE100, so companies which are targeting to only procure renewable energy, electricity, to meet their consumption. In the table, you can see which clean power procurement option exists. I won't go into detail. I would instead prefer to briefly talk about the artificially low retail electricity prices. It's mentioned in small at the bottom of the slide. Often, the retail electricity prices are too low, and the excessively low price is not good to stimulate investments in power plants, in green infrastructure, and also to allow a reasonable profit for investors. The last challenge to be addressed to accelerate the growth of renewable energy in Southeast Asia is international electrical grid, Mathieu presented about, so I will be short. It's very important because it helps to improve economic efficiency, to strengthen energy security, and because it also helps to meet environmental objectives, such as renewable energy integration. As of May 2022, there were 8 gigawatts of cross-border interconnection capacity in operation already in Southeast Asia. If you compare with Europe, it's small, but if you compare with Northeast Asia, it's already quite significant. And the trade was mainly taking place between Laos, thanks to its large hydropower potential, and Thailand, being the net importer of power. And this is my last slide. What needs to be done in the area of international electrical grid is to plan for even more infrastructure and multilateral trade. Today, there are plans to have roughly 30 gigawatts of cross-border electricity trade capacity. It's good. I think it should be praised. But In the first part of my presentation, I also talked about the scenarios with very high share of renewable energy. And in these scenarios, the cross-border capacity is like 150 gigawatts or more of cross-border capacity. So these plants need to be multiplied by five. And finally, last point, it's important that the trade increasingly takes place from bilateral to multilateral. We have recently witnessed with pleasure the first such multilateral pearl trade between Laos, Thailand, Malaysia, and Singapore. So this is a reality. Now Singapore is importing 100 megawatts of hydropower from Laos that flows through the different grids of the other countries. And a new feasibility study has been announced for such multilateral pearl trade between Brunei, Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines. This, I think, is very positive, should be encouraged and pursued always and always more. And that's it for my presentation. Thank you much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Homan-san. So there is a massive renewable energy potential in Southeast Asia. So international organizations are saying that 90% can be the share about in this region. But there are many challenges that need to be addressed. And so after this, we'll be hearing from a Shizen International Inc. CEO, Ryo Ogawa-san, who's actually making the activities in the region. Ogawa-san, the floor is yours.
Which? Japanese or English?
Because most of the participants are Japanese, so please allow me to speak and make a presentation in Japanese. Thank you.
Again, thank you for the kind introduction. I'm with Shizen Energy Inc. My name is Ogawa. I'm in charge of the foreign department and Shizen International. I'm the COO of the subsidiary for overseas operations. Today, I will talk about Shizen Energy's activities in ASEAN. And especially, I will focus on corporate clients, a business model that we apply for corporate clients. First of all, this is who we are. Every year, once a year, all employees get together to hold this, what we call an all meeting. We have about 200 employees at the moment, and as you can see, they are diverse in terms of nationality. We cover 20 nations in terms of the employee nationality coverage. Diversity is one of the characteristics of our company. We were founded right after 2011, in July, after March 11 of that year, Great East Japan earthquake. We are a developer of renewable energy. Three founders inaugurated the company, and the purpose is we take action for the blue planet. We want to hand down the blue planet to future generations. As I said, 200 employees work at our company today. This illustration is the future that we want to achieve. 100% renewable energy. We want to build such a society with our partners, and that has been written into our purpose as we engage in our businesses day in, day out. This is the business overview of Shizen Energy Group. One point that I wish to attract your attention. Many of you are engaged in renewable energy business, I assume, but in creating renewable energy, project has to be developed, and after business development, construction will be the next phase, and then COD and enabler. In Japan, from business to EPC, construction, and OEM, we have a totally integrated process. UE is our joint venture company with whom we did OPC and O&M. But yesterday, we announced a new project, EPC O&M, which was a joint venture with UE. Our company decided to acquire all of the equity. So we will be able to do all of these stages at our company from now on. This is a very broad organization chart. This is our corporate structure. And at the center, our company lies, Shizen Energy. And then beneath, there is the company Shizen International. This is engaged in APAC, Brazil projects. This is the entity that engages in businesses outside of Japan. Global achievements and pipelines. Around the world, 1.2 gigawatt worth of development has been done by our company, and most of that has been in Japan so far. Since 2018, we have been engaged in overseas operations, and today, ASEAN, Thai, Vietnam, Malaysia, Philippines, Indonesia, and in addition, Korea and Australia, we have presence in these areas. Slightly far away, we also have an asset in Brazil, and this project is under development at the moment. The theme is ASEAN. So what have we been doing in ASEAN? I would like to show you photographs later, but Thailand on the top right. On-site, rooftop solar is the main business that we do in Thailand. And then Malaysia. At the beginning, Top Grove, a company manufacturing rubber gloves, was our partner, and we sold rooftop solar panels to that company. We are now going to be launching a large-scale corporate green power producer program. This program was launched last year, which is a larger project. Off-site, there's the generator and then the consumer. And in a case where there is distance, that's the nature of the project. So we start from rooftop, and we are now proceeding to more large-scale projects. Regarding Vietnam, as was already discussed, a feed-in tariff, round one and two, had been conducted, and we have presence in Vietnam. I will show you a photo later, but 35 mega solar and 21 mega wind, we have taken equity and are participating in those projects. And the next in the pipeline is onshore wind, and we are studying the possibility of participating in that project. Going on to Indonesia, I will show you a photo of one project there, but PLA, within the regulation, there are regulation and rooftop solar panel is the business we engage in. In terms of our relationship with Japanese government, JCM, which is the subsidy offered by the Ministry of the Environment, is being used as we expand our business presence in Indonesia. And amongst ASEAN countries, the Philippines. Philippines is an area where we do not have any asset yet, but up to 100 megawatt class onshore wind, we are engaged in the development of this project. And if possible, by the end of this year or early next year, we hope that construction can begin and a study is underway in the Philippines. Now, let me share with you some photos so that it becomes easier to obtain an image of those projects. This is the one in Thailand. Toyota's supplier, Icing Group's plant, 1 megawatt rooftop panel was installed, and in the form of PPA, power is provided downstairs to the floor of the plant. This one is in Indonesia. Location XXX, sorry about that, it hasn't been updated. East of Jakarta, Cikarang is the location. It's a distribution logistical warehouse and SV, PV, 0.8 megawatt approximately generation capacity. And this is a larger scale project. Vietnam FIT was used for this project. Haojian 35 megawatt solar, and we have a majority stake in this project. This one, I didn't want all of the photos to be PV, so this is one for wind, Fumai 3 wind project, onshore wind. And again, we use the FIT regime of Vietnam. 21 megawatt is the generation capacity. 3-4 years have passed since launch of operation. So now that you've seen the photos, I hope you have an image of what we do. We are customer-centric. That's one of the objectives. For important customers, renewable energy solution in diverse manner, we want to offer such solutions. That's one of the objectives. And there are a few schemes through which we offer such solutions as described in this chart. You see the numbers 1, 2, and 3. On-site PPA. As the word on-site explains, most of it is rooftop solar. In the case of rooftop solar panels, the plant operator would purchase, install, and operate. Self-procurement, self-investment. Many projects are such based upon such model, but some plants use third parties like ourselves. The third party constructs, we have the ownership to the panel, and we sell the generated power to the plant underneath the roof. And that's what we refer to as corporate PPA, CPPA. This drawing is a house, more like a house, but basically it's usually a plant in the industry. So for industrial customers, we install the solar panels and sell power to the resident, the plant. The second type is offsite PPA. And there would be a grid in between. So there is the generator, and then there is the consumer, and there is a distance in between. So that's what it means by offsite. And again, offsite corporate PPA is the model we use. We do the development of the power generation facility, and then through it goes through the grid to for the customer to purchase the power. And then the third model. This was touched upon in the presentation, but carbon credit, IREC, intervention. We are engaged in such intervention as well as an intermediary. In the case of ASEAN, except for Singapore, it hasn't developed to that stage yet. But in the case of Japan, this is, I borrowed a chart from REI. Through the wholesale market, virtual PPA is being operated. It's not physical purchase of power, but we offer power to the wholesale market. And through the certificate, this is sold to the consumer. And already in Japan, virtual PPA scheme has been started up. And a similar scheme has begun in Malaysia, CGPPP. I can't give you the name, but Western Data Center, Western Companies Data Center is our customer. And we are studying the possibility of engaging in such business under this business model with that customer. In the case of Japan, the situation is more advanced. We've already announced this project in our press release. The location is Inuyama. And here, Microsoft is our customer. and virtual PPA is offered to Microsoft. So this, it's not a power being sold to Microsoft, but NFC will be sold to Microsoft, and we also engage in PPA. I will not go into the details of the scheme, but that is the kind of business we are engaged in. As I have said, one of our objectives is customer-centric. In this case, the customer is Microsoft. We, in many ways, offer renewable energy to corporate clients, and we want to engage in such business in ASEAN as well. But as indicated in other presentations, there are country by country uniqueness that makes it possible to engage in this kind of model. We have to take into consideration grid distribution or electricity supply in each country. There are countries with stringent regulation. There are countries with laxer regulation. So it's not the case that the scheme is perfectly applicable to all the ASEAN members. Of course, there was a stage in history in Japan where this scheme was not possible even in Japan. But because of the decade-long development of the power market in Japan, we are now able to engage in such scheme in Japan. So we have built up expertise, and we want to use that in ASEAN so that the power market in ASEAN can be reformed, and we private sector operators can offer services to private sector customers like Microsoft, and that would lead to higher level of private sector investment, and private operators can deliver power to those who want to purchase power from renewable energy developer like ourselves. Sorry for going overboard, but that was a presentation on our businesses in ASEAN.
Thank you very much for the presentation. And to meet the demands of the clients and customers, you've been expanding your business in ASEAN. And as Japanese companies, what kind of contribution can be made? And I was aware you provided insights. And we've been hearing about the supply side efforts. And today, amongst the audience, we have Ken Haig-san from Amazon Web Service. And I'd like to hear from you. So from the demand side in the region to enhance renewable energy, what are the work being done? If you can just give a brief comment. And also, if you could give a message to a power user of Japan, that would be appreciated.
Amazon Web Services, the cloud computing part of larger Amazon. I think I'm being asked to comment on behalf of the consumer's perspective. I'll do so on behalf of Amazon. Just to give you some perspective, I think one of the reasons why the consumer voice is important is because it's one of the largest sources of new investment in renewables around the world today. To give you a sense of the kind of scale that we've driven as Amazon, I've been with Amazon for 3 years now. In that time, we've enabled over 30 gigawatts of new renewable capacity around the world to date. Most of that is not in Asia, because it's very hard for us to purchase renewable power in this part of the world. We're trying to fix that. It's not a technology problem. It's a policy and market problem. And that's why we very much appreciate all the work that's being done in these discussions with REI to try and fix some of the policy and market challenges to purchasing renewable power here in Japan. I'll just quickly comment on the Southeast Asia dynamics that were mentioned here, because we also have invested in Southeast Asia. Our first investments in Southeast Asia were in Singapore, to Matthew's point. Singapore has a very limited amount of space for building renewable projects, so we've maxed out, I think, what we can purchase there. They have a very favorable market structure. That virtual PPA structure that Shizen-san just mentioned does apply in Singapore. The problem is there's no sufficient projects there. So they're looking at importing renewable power. We've been watching this very keenly. One of the challenges in that discussion is that for a corporate consumer, they're looking at transferring electrons. They haven't yet solved for how they're going to transfer the environmental attributes from those projects. And for us, that's an important part of considering an investment, because that's the basis for our carbon reduction claim. It's the whole reason we're purchasing renewable power in the first place. And so evidence that we've being able to reduce this much carbon as a part of this purchase is very important for us for making that investment. So we'll be watching for that in Singapore. I was speaking with Fabi at the start of today's discussion, reminiscing that at the end of 2022, we announced a 210 megawatt project with PLN in Indonesia. We thought at the time that this was going to be a structure that others could follow. You know, we would make the first deal with PLN and they would provide similar services for others. We haven't seen that come to fruition yet. I'm hoping still that we'll see more options in Indonesia. But the good news is that in Indonesia's slow response on this, we have seen movement in other parts. So Thailand, for example, is moving forward with a green tariff structure there that most corporate consumers will be able to take advantage of, including a structure that allows for new projects, which is important for us. They have to be additional, above and beyond what's available on the grid today, to count for additionality purposes. So that's something to watch. I think that the Malaysia case that was mentioned is also an important one. Virtual power purchase agreement, if they can get there first, they will be the first in Southeast Asia, other than Singapore, where that's a possibility. Vietnam was moving in this direction, but they've been very slow. We'll see who gets there first, because there's a lot of corporate investment behind this. And I think that's the point I'll end on, is that for enabling corporate renewable procurement like this is quite important as a win-win-win scenario. It's a win for us, obviously, because we have 100% renewable goals that we're trying to meet. It's a win for developers because we can provide the assurance and the what they need to get financing to build the project in the first place. But it's also a win for the grid, because if you're investing at the scale that Amazon is, we're investing in utility scale projects that become a grid resource. We pay for them, but at no additional cost to consumers on the grid, this becomes a grid resource. And so I think it's an important model to harness. Japan could certainly learn from this. Going into this discussion, even though it's ironic that 210 megawatt deal that we've done in PLN in Indonesia, it took time to get across the line, it's still bigger than the cumulative amount of power that we've been able to procure here in Japan. And if a company with Amazon scale cannot procure power at scale in Japan, then there's something wrong with how we're enabling new projects to come online quickly enough to meet the demand that's growing. It's not just Amazon, it's our suppliers, it's our competitors, it's our Japanese counterparts. There are many, many companies looking for renewable power here in Japan. We need more supply to meet that demand. And so I hope that's the point of discussion at the next section. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank
you very much for that. So you're busy, so you can't stay to hear the panel discussion. That is why we were able to hear from you at this moment. Now, we'd like to have a 30-minute break from now. And right outside of this venue, there will be a beverage, a beverage for you. And so please be back here at around 3:37 for us to resume the session. Thank you very much. Thank you very much to be back on time. We'll have to resume the second part. So basing on the reports we heard in the first part, in the second part, we'd like to deepen our discussion, focusing on the collaboration in the region and the role of Japan. I'd like to introduce the speaker next to myself, Simon Holmes Accord, Director at the Smart Energy Council. Australia is shifting from the carbon fossil fuel focus to the renewable energy focus, and the organization is supporting the shift. Thank you very much for today. And next to him, Fabi Tumiwa, Executive Director of the Institute for Essential Services Reform. The ISR is working on research on Indonesia's decarbonization and energy transition, and also related initiatives and policy-making processes. They are having a very active engagement on those topics. Thank you very much for today. And next to him is Ari Izadi. He's a head of Asia-Pacific of the Bloomberg NEF. Bloomberg NEF monitors and captures data on how market is moving amid transition toward decarbonization, and it is providing a timely information and analysis. Thank you very much for your contribution today. Lastly, from the Institute, Executive Director Teruyuki Ono. So at this panel discussion, first, Ono-san will give explanation about the Asian Zero Emission Community concept, ASIC, which the Japanese government is working to deploy mainly in Southeast Asia. And then we'd like to explore what the Japanese strategy means for the energy transition in the region and what role the Japanese government and companies can play in.
Thank you for the kind introduction. My name is Ono. I will be brief and give you an overview on green transformation GX policy that the Japanese government had embarked upon since last year. They are currently doing a lot of propaganda, and there are many problems pertaining to the GX. But part of that is international strategy and ASIC. Asia Zero Emission Community is part of the GX strategy. But is this truly going to contribute to the decarbonization of Asia, Southeast Asia? We have much skepticism. And let me introduce to you some of the points of concern. Now, this ASIC was officially announced 2 years ago, 2022, January, when Prime Minister Kishida made a policy speech at the Diet. And he announced that he wants to contribute to the decarbonization of Asia. Of course, when you read about ASIC, they talk about expansion of renewable energy. In letter, that's what they write. But if you actually look at the deed, the Kishida administration, or METI, isn't really focusing on that particular point. That's not their priority. And in parallel to ASIC, since a little before ASIC, they started, the Asia CCUS network was launched. And CCS or CCU or CCUS, main is CCUS. Not the utility part, but capture and storage, and doing that mainly in Asia. So what are the bases of our skepticism? When the government and officers of METI repeatedly say that the decarbonization of Asia has to take place, and in Southeast Asia, they say the renewable energy resources potential is too small. That's what they assert repeatedly, which is not a fact. And our fellow, Roman, also mentioned that. And they say many things, but let me give you some of the examples, which is not factual. METI's Oil and Natural Gas Subcommittee of the Natural Resources and Energy Subcommittee was held. And here, this is an excerpt of the minutes. Fast-growing economies in Asia are forced to choose to use fossil fuels. That's the expression you use. They use. And after the appointment of Prime Minister Kishida, he went to COP26, and he delivered a speech at COP. And he says as follows in his statement. Since solar power plays a major role in the transition to renewables in Asia, to help stabilize electrical frequency in the region, converting existing thermal power generations into zero-emission power generation is a necessary path. So he admits that there's solar energy, but I think it's a biased view. And he says that this is necessary in order to decarbonize and depart from fossil fuel. And they are asserting two means. One is ammonia coal firing. And there are many problems to this. But environmentally, even if you do 20% coal firing, it doesn't lead to reduction of emissions. You see the diagram, and you've probably seen this over and over again because it's used in many meetings. But even if 20%, in comparison to natural gas, coal thermal power plants emit double. So it's going to be still very bad. and JERA, since late March, is going to do a major scale demonstration, and they've made that announcement for co-firing at 20%. But even with 20% co-firing, it's not going to cause much impact. And taking that kind of criticism into consideration, JERA recently began to say they're going to be engaged in 50% co-firing. But even with 50% co-firing, it's worse, a little bit worse than natural gas thermal. In the early 2030s, we want to phase out fossil fuel in the 2030s. But Japan is talking about finally 50% co-firing, which will be slightly worse than at par with natural gas thermal. And some say 100% co-firing with ammonia. But technically speaking, 20%, 50% co-firing, 100% co-firing, it's not just an extension. It requires a completely different technology for 100% co-firing. So green ammonia, if they're saying green ammonia, but I wonder why they have chosen co-firing, which is so complicated, and I wonder why they want to export that to Southeast Asia. So that's the environmental front. And then the cost front, it's going to be expensive. And Roman reported this already, but existing coal thermal, in comparison, the renewable energy power generation, PV, wind, is cheaper. And then this is going to mean added cost because of ammonia co-firing. So it's going to be more expensive than existing coal thermal. 1 kilowatt hour, 20-some yen is the estimate, so which is extremely prohibitive. So is there room to do this in scale? JERA is a member of the government council, and they said it's costly. So government has to provide us with a support equivalent to the support government is offering to renewables. 1 kilowatt hour, 20 yen or more. That's the cost. Well, 20 yen per kilowatt hour is the old historical price of renewables. It's no longer at that level. And are they really going to do that? And even if they do that in Japan, why export such a fiscally heavily burdened scheme to other countries? And another point is CCS. Now, I'm not going to speak in detail about CCS, but some of the sectors that are difficult to abate, maybe this is a way, a choice, but what the Japanese government is recommending is scale CCS at scale in thermal power plants. 2050, CCS thermal accounts for 30% of the energy mix. That's the picture the government is drawing. So this is beyond what is acceptable. And if they do that, they use that for generation and they use that for other things. And then even if the emission could be absorbed, where are they going to store that absorbed CO2? Is there potential in Japan for storage? No, because no specific site has been designated. And without designated site for storage, and they say they are going to look for sites, but 2-3 years ago, there were candidate sites. But they were beginning to say, we send it to Southeast Asia or Australia and ask those countries to store. They weren't advocating that at loud voice, but now they have begun to boldly say that in public. When they came up with the 6th Strategic Energy Plan, they did a study. There 235 to 282 million tons of CO2 to be exported from Japan. That's the scheme that the government has in mind. And that's already a quarter of total emissions of Japan. And they're thinking about exporting as much as a quarter of Japanese CO2 to other countries. Is this a sustainable scheme? Do you think this is an acceptable scheme? We have many questions. So there are several problems. But the government is still trying to proceed with ASIC. So I hope that you can take those points into consideration and think about the problems and think what the Japanese government and Japan should do. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. So I forgot to mention two things. I forgot to first self-introduce myself. I'm Okubo from the Institute. As much as I can keep using my voice, I will keep asking questions. Another thing, yesterday we had the RE Vision. And could you raise your hand if you have already heard the presentation from the same speakers that are on the stage today? Well, thank you very much. Yes, thank you. I will use that as information for our facilitation. Now, Simon-san, I have a question, Simon-san. So yesterday, you said that Australia is now, well, Japan is importing the fossil fuel from Australia. So many Japanese people thought that the Australia is a country with a focus on fossil fuel. But you have changed a very rapid change already. And we're surprised, quite frankly. And the maybe there are some audience who are not here yesterday. So before going about talking about the problems with regards to ASIC, could you just repeat the essence of yesterday's presentation, especially the decline of the usage of fossil fuel and the increase of renewable energy in Australia? Could you refer to those to begin with?
Thank you, and I appreciate this opportunity to present. So Australia has traditionally been a large exporter of fossil fuels to Japan. I believe about 40% of Japan's LNG comes from Australia and about 60 to 70% of the thermal coal. We are also a large supplier of metallurgical coal. Australia itself is under a very fast energy transition in our own grids. Up on the screen, I have a representation of the transition from 12 years ago to the present in the middle to projections by the grid operator for 12 years from now. 12 years ago, we were only 10% renewable with 27 coal power stations. We are now 39% renewable and half of the power stations have closed with a 30% drop in emissions as a result. In 12 years' time, it's projected that there may only be one coal power station left. We will be 95% renewable and have slashed emissions by 95%. So we are making very quick transition in our grid. One of our states, South Australia, is several years ahead of the rest of the country and expects to be a net 100% renewable by 2027. So they're moving quite quickly. They are now at a situation where they no longer have baseload generation. They have a lot of wind and a lot of solar. They have gas and they have batteries. And batteries are coming in very fast in Australia. In 6 years, we introduced the 6 years from 1997 to 2002, inclusive, we introduced 1 gigawatt of batteries. We did another 1 gigawatt last year, and we are on track to, we have 5 gigawatts under construction. So we are exponentially growing our battery, and what we are seeing is that the batteries are pushing gas out. So our network is rapidly moving to one that is wind and solar, backed up by storage being pumped hydro and batteries, firmed with those, and then backed up with gas. But gas is that little orange piece down the bottom, so a very small wedge going forward. Now, as we reduce our emissions, in the electricity sector, emissions in other sectors are becoming more prominent or attracting more attention. The transport sector is one, and we are in the process of introducing fuel efficiency standards, which surprisingly Australia does not have at the moment, and surprisingly, maybe not surprisingly, there is political pressure being asserted by Toyota to stop us doing this, which is very frustrating. But As another significant part of our emissions is the fugitive emissions. That is the emissions that get released by us extracting the gas and processing it, liquefying it to put onto the LNG ships. And also in digging up the coal, there is significant fugitive emissions that come out of the mines when it is extracted. So those are becoming, they are a significant problem for us. So I'd like to make sure it is well known that Japan's carbon problem is also Australia's carbon problem. And we have an interesting geopolitical situation where our Pacific neighbours, many Pacific Island nations, are putting a lot of pressure on Australia to stand by its word to decarbonise, at the same time as we are feeling a lot of pressure from Japan to increase our supply or increase our development of fossil fuels. So we in Australia sit in an awkward position.
Thank you very much. In 12 years, coal thermal has gone down so significantly. Coal is one of the biggest resources of Australia. So emissions are coming down, but what about export? Export is the problem where there's emission, and that's where Japan comes into the picture. Thank you very much. So another point, carbon thermal is coming down. Later on, I'm going to ask you some specific questions, but one point regarding coal thermal plants significantly being closed. In the case of Japan, IPCOs would speak out and complain. So regarding closure of coal thermal power plants, is there any guarantee paid by the government, cash transfer? How did you convince those IPCOs to close?
Our energy market does not have capacity payments. And our energy market also has negative prices when there is surplus demand. And the coal power stations have seen the value of their product reduce over time. We don't have a carbon price, but as renewables have come in, and very significantly, rooftop solar. Rooftop solar is three quarters of all the solar in Australia, and year in, year out, we see 3 to 3.5 gigawatts of new rooftop solar being added, and that is pushing out the coal in the middle of the day and pushing out the economics of coal. The coal companies at first pushed hard against renewables and against this scheme, but in recent years, the coal generators have all announced that they are rapidly building a pipeline of renewable energy projects. Many of them have many projects underway. It was disappointing to me to hear mentions of carbon capture and storage that the technology is still in active discussion here. We still talk about carbon capture and storage as being a solution for difficult to abate sectors. So maybe for certain industrial processes, relatively small amounts and niche issues, and probably in the far future. But in Australia, all of our techno-economic analysis has shown that there is no business case for CCS in the energy sector. The world's largest CCS project is in Western Australia at the Gorgon plant. For the first 5 years, it barely worked, and now it is working at about one-third capacity and cost an immense amount. We see that the $50 to $150 premium that would be added on to a retrofit of a plant to CCS makes the technology completely uneconomic. And if you do any analysis of the cost of transitioning to renewables to the cost of retrofitting CCS, you'll see that it just does not make any sense, any rational sense, to add CCS to the electricity sector.
Thank you very much. Now, Japan's strategy to maintain the fossil fuel-fired power generation such in the Asian region, on that I'd like to come back to this topic. So Australia is a part of the ASIC. So the Japan's strategy is to maintain a fossil fuel. But if my memory is correct, last year, Australia also took part in the renewable energy promoted by Europe. with the intention to increase the investment in renewable energy in the region. I heard about the coverage. So what is the strategy of Australia in relation to Southeast Asia, or the view about the region? What is the vision of Australia?
Look, I would say we are two-faced in this regard. We are happy to keep selling LNG and coal. We use the drug dealer's defense, which is if we didn't sell it, you'd buy it from somebody else. There are obviously moral issues with this, but our fossil fuel industry is happy to take Japanese money. But there is a large part of Australia and our Pacific nations that are very concerned about the continued expansion or continued exploration for new coal reserves and new gas reserves. These are facing significant political pressure, and it should be said that there is now quite a strong political force in our parliament that is speaking up for a moratorium on new developments. And I mentioned before that pressure coming from our Pacific Island nation, mm-hmm. Our Pacific family, as Australia calls it. It is becoming increasingly uncomfortable for us to be to continue to be a major supplier of carbon into Southeast Asia, and I expect that pressure will only ramp up. We've made commitments to reduce it. Japan has made commitments to reduce it. So I think any long-term vision of continuation of fossil fuels at anything like the levels they are now is breaching the commitments that Australia and Japan have made to the international community and through that to each other.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask you some follow-up questions later. Bobby, in Indonesia, we issued a report on Indonesia, and I asserted in that report, this is nothing new, but Japan, at least 11 gigawatt coal thermal. Japan is supporting the coal projects in Indonesia, but more than half came in online in the past couple of years, or will become online in a couple of years. PLN, 25-year PPA. So that's where we are. And then Japan is trying to do ammonia co-firing, and Indonesia wants to, of course, have those thermal power plants come online because you are indebted. So that's why the interests meet between the Japanese government and Indonesia. But at the same time, feasibility investigation has been done for ammonia co-firing, and many projects have been started up. And if you read those reports, you understand that this is going to be a huge amount of enormous cost, additional cost. Of course, the coal thermal plants have already been constructed. The gas thermal power plants have already been constructed. And it's Mitsubishi Heavy Industries' example, but it's going to be quadruple. That's the best case. And it's going to be quadruple the cost, even in the best case. And what about the pipeline for bringing in ammonia? And so it's blue ammonia, so you have to have CCS. Where do you store? You have to develop the storage place. And it's going to take more than 7 years to have that ready. So Indonesian government, PLN, the state-owned power company, ODA loan. Is there a possibility for them to borrow an ODA loan to go ahead with that project?
That's a tough question. Well, if you look at the economics of ammonia co-firing, even CCUS in Indonesia, the answer is very clear that it's not economically feasible. And a number of studies has shown that ammonia co-firing in Indonesia could increase the electricity from coal fire power plant like four times higher. And as today, coal is seen as the cheapest electricity sources in Indonesia. And the reason, because government gave us heavy subsidy to the coal through domestic market obligation, domestic cap price that maintain like whatever the price of coal at in international market, our utility purchase coal with $70 per ton. That makes coal electricity from coal generations keep lower all the time, because that the government policies to maintain the stable electricity supplies, right? So not necessary that coal is cheap. We have seen that coal price is actually very high, and government gave still, although coal price is subsidized, the government still provides subsidy for the electricity tariff. So we subsidize the coal when we subsidize the tariff, right? And the subsidies getting higher and higher for electricity. In combined subsidy and compensations last year, I think is around $12 billion for subsidy, electricity, and compensations alone to the utilities. So it's pretty high. So we can imagine that if the electricity from coal getting more, from coal plants getting more expensive, it means that the government has to increase the subsidy at the electricity price, because this very, very sensitive issue is a politically sensitive. And that's the real case, right, I think. So what's going to happen if coal with ammonia co-firings come online? Some study has shown that 20% or 50% could increase between 2 to 4 times. Right? So we expect that coal, average coal generation cost in Indonesia now is like 6 cents per kilowatt hour. Right? So it could be double, even triple. So it could be between 12 to 18 cent dollar per kilowatt hour. Depends on number of fleets. So we can see that maybe electricity price could increase half, right? And that amount of the subsidy that's going to be provided. So if you look at the economics, so there is no, not only the economic viability is not there, but also it will create additional fiscal burden to the government. And there's some implication, because your fiscal space is very limited, then the government has to slash other development program, for instance, just to subsidize the electricity. So there's no point, right? I mean, if we look at this case, so not only economically viable, but also politically not viable. So as Indonesian citizen, I will say, I don't want to take that loan, unless it's given for free. We don't have to pay, but it become a burden of Japanese citizens.
We would miss our tax. Okay. CCS.
Right, so another point. With regards to CCS, I'd like to also ask for your insight. So earlier, Ono-san said that in Japan, the CO2 emitted from the power generation in Japan, the destination which is being explored. And are the people of the Indonesia know about that, that Japan is looking for a place to store the CO2 emitted from Japan, and the Indonesia government? Is the Indonesia government, well, made announcements to support the CCS? But in Indonesia, was there a sufficient discussion or analysis with regards to the issue of safety, or the whose responsibility is it to manage? Do you feel that there is sufficient discussion in the country?
Following last year summit between Indonesia government and Japanese government, I think in March last year, right, if I'm not mistaken, March last year or April last year, somewhere around that time, right? The one of the cooperation that we signed is actually for CCS and co-firing. That's two under ASEC. And after that, Indonesian government is pretty much excited with the opportunities of carbon capture and storage. So last January, the government issued presidential regulations on the carbon capture and storage, which currently there's like 15 CCS prospective project. I think around half of it, mostly in the oil and gas sectors, but around half of it, I think, in cooperation with Japanese companies. And one project that will come on, there's a two project that will come on, half of it will come online before 2030, but two that will come online in 2026 and 2027. One is Gundi project, it's an oil and gas field in Central Java, and another one in Tangguh, which is owned by BP. So the government estimated that Indonesia could store more than 12 gigaton of CO2, I mean, with the current storage in the different geological formations, right? And but these two projects, I forget what is their capacities because it will come, and the other eight. So the regulation that issued last January actually make kind of permission for and kind of layout procedures of having carbon capture and storage projects, and the permit issuance and others, but lack of safeguard, responsibility is not discussed there. So it's all like technical guidelines on how to get permit, how for how long and others, but not really how to address the risks, how to ensure that the CO2 doesn't leak, and if it leaks, if there is a leakage, who is responsible to that, how the insurance mechanism and others. So basically, I can say that this regulation is lacking of a lot of important thing. But what very interesting from that regulation is that the government say that we reserve 30% of our storage capacity for international CO2 trading. So it means that if any country is willing to store the CO2 in Indonesia, the government already prepare or guarantee the storage capacities, and you have to pay. How much is it? We don't know yet. But I think that also, there's still a number of regulation that will be discussed. But I think that's, and if we look at the interest, is actually Indonesia and Japan government is working toward like pilot project of storage this. And I think using Japan-Indonesia cooperation in the number of energy project also could be, could facilitate this kind of cooperation in the near future.
Ali,
the next question is addressed to you. At Bloomberg, you do the cost analysis of country-by-country technologies. What do you think about ASIC strategy? And what about Japan? What kind of impact is Japan causing? Are we being successful? Thank you. When we do such analysis, as mentioned by Simon and Fabi, we apply the same concept. for coal-fired power stations, CCS is not economically attractive. The problem with regards to CCS is they call it CCS, but CO2 is captured, and what's captured is delivered, and then somewhere you have to process it. So in order to cut CO2, in the case of coal-fired thermal power stations, it requires energy. The well-known case of coal plant with CCS is Petronova project in the United States. And the Petronova project, the steam turbine, they have four turbines, and one is with capturing. And in order to offer energy, they had to install a new gas turbine. So in order to capture the CO2 of carbon thermal power plant, they install gas turbine, and using heat and electricity from the gas turbine, capturing is being done. So in the end, even if it's direct captured, 90% is directly captured, gas turbine eats up the fuel, the energy. So the emission will go up anyways. So in the end, if you manage that project well, maybe 30% at the best emissions reduction may be achieved, at the best. If possible, if you have a nearby renewable energy plant in proximity facility, it would be better, but you can't do that anywhere in any geography, so that's one challenge, and it's costly, as Fabi has mentioned. So then we want to deliver CO2, so what do we do? If you have a place nearby, maybe it could be carried in pipeline, then it won't be that prohibitive in terms of cost. But say you have to transport by vessel, like Japan is thinking, then it is going to be extremely costly. So economic viability will be undermined. And finally, if you look at global CCS projects to date, performance, there were some cases where performance was good, but most of them, EOR, enhanced oil recovery, so CO2 wasn't reduced. So CO2 is absorbed for more fossil fuel. That CCS is all about, right? Right. And as Simon said, of the Gorban project, you mentioned that project. If you want excess Indonesia, there hasn't been any successful cases so far, not yet. In the case of coal thermal power plants, to the extent possible, for CO2 emissions reduction, I don't think CCS should be considered.
Thank you very much. We're running out of time. We wish to have another round of the questions and to discuss a more positive note. And just I'd like to hear one word each from the participant to talk about the role of the Japanese companies. And then we'd like to have a Q&A with the audience. Simon-san, so the relationship with Japan to shift from fossil fuel to renewable energy based, and as the relationship is to change to more green in nature, what industry do you have expectation for?
So Australia is blessed with a large landmass. We have 20 times the landmass of Japan. We have amazing sun and wind resources, but we have one quarter of the population. Large amounts of Australia are suitable for renewable energy development and will produce the world's cheapest energy in a decarbonizing world. Now, through an accident of physics, it is very cheap to move carbon in the form of coal around the world by ship, but it is very expensive to move hydrogen by ship. There's nothing we can do about those physics that was set in the physical laws from the start of time. So in a decarbonizing world, it makes sense to move the industry towards the source of energy. We see that companies that wish to remain competitive will move the energy-intensive parts of their business, the most energy-intensive parts, to where the energy is. And in the case, I'll give the example of steel. The best quality the best reserves of iron ore anywhere near Japan are from Australia, and we supply a lot of iron ore to Japan. We envisage that the iron ore plus green hydrogen will produce green iron and then be shipped in briquetted form or sponge iron to Japan, where Japan's steel industry will turn the green iron into green steel, and the rolling and all of the high value adding and industrial process downstream industry will continue to benefit from Japan's skill and investment there. But we expect that if companies that wish to remain competitive in these high in these industries that use a lot of coal right now, we'll see them move the energy-intensive parts to Australia. And this is happening. This is happening with lithium already. Australia is the largest producer of lithium in the world. 50% or just over of all the lithium in all the electric vehicles in the world is coming from Australia right now. And we are starting to process that in Australia. We used to send it to China and they would upgrade it there, but increasingly it is recognised that there is an economic advantage and a security advantage in having that lithium upgraded using Australian energy.
Thank you, Fabi. The situation is quite challenging in Indonesia. In the timeline of the next 2 and 3 years, where should the funding go to? And what should Japan do in order to promote energy transition in Indonesia? In 1 minute, please.
If we are looking at the urgencies to address climate crisis, of course, if we have resources, money has to be spent to the real solution, not to the false solutions. And we know that keeping fossil fuels is not only economically unviable, but also it's harm to the climate. So I think if you look at that, then the action should go to renewables in this case. And a number of studies, again, a couple of studies has shown that renewables, including variable renewable energy plus storage, actually is way cheaper than options like coal. Our study with BNEF 2 years ago shows that before 2030, even right with the current economics, solar, wind plus battery is actually cheaper than new coal plants. So it makes sense for a country like Indonesia to ramp up variable renewable energy, solar and wind. And well, we have very few wind, but solar we have plenty. Coupling with storage, I think, would be the solution, not goes into the fall solutions like CCS or ammonia co-firing. And adding others also, very important that this energy transition has dimension of just. Mm. Right? So it's just energy transition. It means that we have to create jobs. And I think a number of countries, including Australia, others who's experiencing rapid renewable energy deployment, shows that renewable energy now create more job than fossil fuels. So that's where the money should go. That's where this technical assistance support, ODA money, should go.
Thank
you very much for the valuable message, Ari-san. So Japanese companies in this region, what can they do? What are their expected roles for the Japanese companies? Understood. Right. So at the earlier, Okubo-san says that the financialization of Japan made investment in Indonesia. That was explained. Maybe many of you are already aware, but the existing thermal power plant, the JBIC, has provided the finance to the coal thermal JBIC, and the Japanese government and like mega banks in Japan also, in addition to JBIC, have provided finance. And in those cases, the Japanese government are involved in JBIC as well. And the mega banks are member of the Z funds as well. So if Japanese governments and the financial institutions of Japan are to support energy transition in Indonesia and Vietnam, then what needs to be done first is to resolve the issue with regards to the investment in existing thermal plants. Okubo-san, as you mentioned at the onset, at the interest rate of the JBIC, if it is to be changed, then the 25-year PPA could be changed. In that case, to the PLN, it can have a more accessibility to change the grid. Well, the power capacity is in excess at this moment with PLN. Well, I know that time is limited, but the Roman-san and Ono-san explained that Prime Minister Kishida said that the solar generation is increasing in Southeast Asia, and for the power conditioning or adjustment, the existing thermal power is needed. So how? Their carbon dioxide emission can be reduced in that context. But in case of the coal thermal, it is using a steam turbine. So in case of steam turbine, it cannot be used for the power conditioning because the reaction speed is slow, too slow for that purpose. The open cycle gas turbine, it can be used for the conditioning or adjustment, but for example, in case of Australia, the coal thermal is not that quite supporting renewable energy, like a battery and such are effective in supporting the renewable energy. If the renewable energy is to be supported, open cycle gas turbines capacity, if it is to increase, that is the one way, but in that case, the fossil fuel demand for fossil fuel is not going to go up. So support should be given in a way the fossil fuel demand is not going to go up.
Thank you for waiting. Ladies and gentlemen, we now would like to take questions from the floor. And we want to extend this session for another 5 minutes. So those of you who have the time, please remain. Any hands? The person at the front. Gentlemen, can you stand up, please? And please wait until the microphone is brought to you. Thank you. On energy transition, in the case of Japan, unlike other countries, you hear in the news, even if there is flood, no one talks about that connected to climate change. And politicians and CEO of large corporates and officials of ministries and agencies, they don't really do much communication that climate change is going to destruct our society right now or in the future. So I think this is a problem of press and education. We have non-Japanese participants, panelists. So what's the situation in your countries? Do you face the similar problem? of education and the press reporting? Are they cautioning the necessity of decarbonization from the climate change perspective? For example, in Australia, according to what I hear, there was a big forest fire, and you reported that that's connected to climate change. So is that truly connected to decarbonization policies or completely decoupled? Thank you very much.
Yes, I failed to mention, but this session is being recorded and will be posted on the web afterwards. So please understand that. So Sonia-san, please. So please mention your name and affiliation and ask your question. Please bring the microphone.
My name is Sonia Dunlop. I am the CEO of the Global Solar Council, the World Solar PV Industry Association. My question is about the comments made by Prime Minister Kishida. And I wanted to ask two things. First of all, has he continued to make those kinds of statements since about the deployment of solar in Southeast Asia undermining electrical frequency? And can we, you know, get a message to him that actually inverters, you know, solar PV inverters actually can support the grid, can support the frequency and everything else the grid needs with much more accuracy and much more speed than thermal power generation? And how can we really counter this myth that clearly is being propagated by the highest levels of the Japanese government in Japan and across Southeast Asia? Thank you.
Simon, can you answer the first question? And then Ono-san can respond to the second question.
So the first question was about whether the media connects climate disasters, climate change or carbon emissions to increasing prevalence and severity of natural disasters. I would say that Australian media is polarised. We have two quite different camps, and it very much aligns with political ideology, I think. The left and centre of our media absolutely make that connection and make that connection regularly. The right wing of our media either ignore it or make fun of the connection. It is very frustrating. So it has fallen down political lines. But one thing that we notice in Australia is every time there is a natural disaster, and we can have bushfires and floods happening in the same week. It's quite incredible the weather extremes. We've always had it's always been a tough climate in Australia, but it is getting the frequency of these events and the severity are increasing, and every time they happen, the public does notice, and it does move the political pendulum towards the political forces that are accepting of the science and accepting of the need to respond to it. So, although some of the media and some of the politicians don't want to make that connection, the Australian people on the whole are doing so.
Thank you very much, Ono-san. So first question, is Kishida, Prime Minister Kishida continuing the same comments? Well, whether good or not, he doesn't really make talk a lot about the climate change. So I don't know what he's saying at this moment, but I don't think he's really making any significant comments. And frequency control or the other measures being possible. So the possibility of the different options are not quite understood in Japan. And under the Japanese government panel or the energy-related committees related to government, what are said is the following. So with your many justification being given, what are said from those who like to continue using the thermal power, they are saying that the connection to the renewable energy is to confuse the grid. And actually, inertia is the thing that's getting attention at this moment. And without the thermal power, there will be a loss of inertia leading to the instability that has been said. And but using battery, for example, the stability, it can be secured without problem. And this discussion, we are making this case from before, but lately, as Simonsen saying, in South Australia, there are actual cases where without thermal power, with the massive power, the stability of the grid is maintained. This is the actual case already being materialized. In the coming energy basic strategy discussion in Japan, what is to happen, we'd like to make stronger case to get rid of the myth. We'd like to work with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We hardly have any time, but last minute firing burning question? Just one question? If not, then again, let's give an applause to the panelists. The documents of today and the video recording, and yesterday we did the event, and the video from yesterday will also be uploaded soon. And on our website, you can download the new Indonesia report. So please continue to follow our institute and know better about Southeast Asia and Australia, because interesting things are happening in terms of energy transition in Australia and other countries. So please continue to follow us. Thank you very much for staying until the very end.